In lecture series on introduction to radar systems, we were discussing tracking radar. Now we will discuss the sequential lobing and conical scan type of tracking radars. First, consider the sequential lobing type. Simple pencil beam antenna is not suitable for tracking radars unless means are provided for determining the magnitude and direction of the target's angular position with respect to some reference direction, usually the axis of antenna. The difference between the target position and the reference direction is called the angular error. A tracking radar attempts to position the antenna to make the angular error zero. When the angular error is zero, the target is located along the reference direction. So, if we consider sequential lobing, this is the center of beam 1 and this is the center of beam 2. So switching axis is this. So this is the direction actually. Now we are assuming target position is here. So let us see how it will work when the target position and the switching axis are having a certain angle between them. So this distance, angular distance, is the angular error. So job of this antenna, job of this sequential lobing radar is to minimize this error to zero. So when the radar is when the radar will track the target, this angular error will be zero. So this is the objective. So if we plot this thing in polar coordinate, so this is the direction of the switching axis, this one. It is not drawn. This one is the switching axis. So this distance, angular distance, is the angular error. One method of obtaining the direction and the magnitude of the angular error in one coordinate is by alternately switching the antenna beam between two positions. That means the same antenna beam, first it will move in this direction, then it will produce this beam in position 2. So same beam, alternately switch between position 1 and position 2. So this is what is done in sequential lobing. This is called the lobe switching, sequential switching, or the sequential lobing. The difference in amplitude between the voltages obtained in the two switched position is a measure of angular displacement of the target from switching axis. So if this is the target, this blue beam or beam 1, its amplitude will be this much. This is the target position, so its amplitude will be this much. And for beam position 2, the amplitude will be this much. So under this condition, beam position 2 will have higher amplitude than the beam position 1. So position 1 will have this much amplitude, position 2 will have higher amplitude, and this will be alternately switched like this. The difference in amplitude between the voltages obtained in the two switched position is a measure of the angular displacement of the target from the switching axis. The sign of the difference determines the direction of the antenna must be moved in order to align the switching axis with the direction of the target. When the voltages in the two switched positions are equal, the target is on axis and its position is determined from the antenna direction. So this direction, switching axis direction. An important feature of sequential lobing is that the target position accuracy can be far better than that given by the antenna beam width. The accuracy depends on how well equally of the signals in the switch position can be determined. equality of the signals in the switch position can be determined. The fundamental limitation to accuracy is system noise caused either by mechanical or electrical fluctuations. Now consider its counterpart, the conical scanning. So it is a logical extension of the simultaneous lobing technique, is to rotate continuously an offset antenna beam. This is what we call the conical scanning. So if this is the antenna beam, this is the beam axis, this dotted line, and we will select another axis of rotation. This is the rotation axis, and about this rotation axis, this beam axis will rotate in this way. So antenna beam will produce this type of circle. If we place one screen right here, it will produce a circle like this. This antenna beam, tip of this antenna beam, will produce a circle like this. At the midpoint, it is the B. The beam axis and the axis of rotation is the squint angle. So the angle between the axis of rotation B and the axis of antenna beam is the squint angle. Now consider the target at position A. Now the echo signal amplitude will be modulated at a frequency equal to the rotation frequency of the beam. Since the beam is rotating in this way, and if this is the target position, so when beam is away from the target, it will produce less amplitude, and as it moves towards the target, it will produce gradually, it will produce higher amplitude. And when it is on the target or very close to the target, its amplitude will be maximum. So within this rotation, during this rotation, the amplitude of the received pulse will be modulated in this way. As you can see here. So more close to the target means higher amplitude, less close to the target, away from the target means lower amplitude. The echo signal amplitude will be modulated at a frequency equal to the rotation frequency of the beam. So this frequency is the rotation frequency. The amplitude of the echo signal modulation will depend upon the shape of the antenna pattern, the squint angle, and the angle between the target line, line of sight, and the rotation axis. The phase of the modulation depends on the angle between the target and the rotation axis. The conical scan modulation is extracted from the echo signal and applied to a servo control system which continuously position the antenna on the target. When the antenna is on the target, that means when A is on the B, the line of sight of the target and the rotation axis coincide, and the conical scan modulation is zero. So more this angle means higher will be the modulation index. This portion will be lower and this portion will be higher. And when A and B are closer, close enough, then this lower portion will be in higher direction and this portion will be in the lower direction. And ultimately, when they are exactly coincides, it will produce a simple constant without variation. This amplitude variation, there will be no amplitude variation of the received pulse at all. That means A and B are now coincident. So this is the block diagram of such conical scan radar. The antenna is mounted so that it can position in both azimuth and elevation by separate motors, which might be either electric or hydraulic driven. The antenna beam is offset by tilting either the feed or the reflector with respect to one another. If the feed maintains the plane of polarization fixed as it rotates, it is called the nutting field. Otherwise, it is called the rotating field. Now consider this block diagram. This is the transmitter, this is the duplexer, and it is going to the rotary joint of the antenna. So beam is transmitted. Now once received, duplexer will switch it to the receiver. The receiver must be with AGC. Then it will be detected and pass through a range gate. The range gate output will be the error signal that will fed to the angle error detectors. Now we have two angle error detectors, one for azimuth angle and another for elevation angle. The same motor that provides the conical scan rotation of the antenna beam and also drives a two-phase reference generator with two outputs 90 degree apart in phase. One is sine, another is cos. Sine is given to the elevation angle and cosine signal is given to the azimuth angle. These two outputs serve as reference to extract the elevation and azimuth errors. The receiver is conventional super heterodyne, save for features related to the conical scan tracking radar. The conical scan modulation or error signal is extracted after the second detector in the video portion of the receiver. The error signal is compared with the elevation and azimuth reference signals in the angle error detectors, which are phase sensitive detectors. These are phase sensitive detectors. The phase sensitive detector is a non-linear device in which the input signal is mixed with the reference signal. The output DC voltage reverses polarity as the phase of the input signal changes through 180 degree. The magnitude of the DC output from the angle error detector is proportional to the error, and the sign, that means the polarity, is an indication of the direction of the error. The angle error detector outputs are amplified and drive the antenna elevation and azimuth servo motors. The angular position of the target may be determined from the elevation and azimuth of the antenna axis. Now we will consider the limitation to tracking accuracy. What are the factors that controls the accuracy of the tracking? Now, accuracy of tracking radar depends on several factors are there. First one is the glint or angle noise. Second one is the receiver noise. And third one is the amplitude fluctuations of the target echo. And these three are most important. Apart from these three, some other factors are also there, like mechanical properties of the antenna, the servo system itself, the method by which the pointing of the antenna both side is determined, the antenna beam width, atmospheric effects, multipath. These are the other factors on which the accuracy of the radar depends. Now consider the glint. If you consider a very complex target and the target is closed enough, in that case, a complex target consists of number of simple scatterers, n number of simple scatterers. At larger distance, all the scatterers will look like a single scatterer. But when the target is closed enough, in that case, the radar can determine different scatterers at different positions. So, an extended target may have, for the sake of simplicity, let us take that extended target has three different scatterers. So three different single scatterers. So the echo from each scatterer's scattering center arrive at the antenna with slightly different wave tilts. For example, from this simple target, they are actually on the same target, same extended target. So one portion of the target producing this simple scatterer and corresponding wave front is this one. This one. Similarly, from scatterer 2, simple scatterer 2, corresponding wave front is say this one, and from or single scatterer 3, wave front is this one. So each scatterer will produce its own wave front, which is tilted to one another. These tilted wave fronts add vectorially across the aperture to give a composite wave front whose amplitude and phase are not uniform across the aperture. The result of having a non-uniform wave front from a complex target, when the radar is designed to process the echo wave front that is planar, is an error in the measurement of the angle of arrival. The measured angle does not bear a simple relationship to some distinctive properties of the target, such as its center, leading edge, or its largest scatterer. Furthermore, the measured angle of arrival can sometimes cause the boresight of the tracking antenna to point outside the angular extent of the target, which can cause the radar to break the track. So blint can be a major source of error when making angle measurements, especially at short range, where the angular extent of the target can be relatively large. Now consider the receiver noise. All theoretical expressions for the RMS value of the error of a radar measurement are inversely proportional to the square root of the signal to noise ratio. Now RMS value of radar measurement error is directly proportional to the square of the range. Receiver noise is a major factor limiting the accuracy of the radar at long ranges where SNRs are small. So receiver noise actually dominates when the range of the target is larger, and glint dominates when the range of the target is lower. Now consider the amplitude fluctuations. The amplitude of radar echo signal from a complex target with multiple scattering centers will fluctuate as the aspect of the target changes with respect to the radar. Conical scan and sequential lobing radars interpret any change in amplitude of the target echo signal as being due to the target not being on both sides. Then direct the antenna to move in a direction to make the error signal zero. Thus, a change in amplitude due to fluctuation in the target echo during the time interval of the sequential measurement can degrade the accuracy of the measurement. The amplitude fluctuations of the echo, does not affect the angle error measurement for monopulse radar. Now we will consider some other errors, like other factors. One of them is the servo noise. This is the hunting action of the tracking servo mechanism, which results from backlash and compliance in the gear, shafts and structures of the antenna mount. The magnitude of this noise is independent of the target echo and will therefore be independent of range. Now if we draw all these different errors and you will try to compare monopulse and say conical scan type of thing. So when the radar range is plotted against radar range, so if you consider the glint actually reducing with radar range, but for lower radar range the glint is very high. Similarly, receiver noise, this blue dotted line, receiver noise more the distance, more the range, more is the receiver noise. Servo noise is almost independent of the radar range. Similarly, amplitude fluctuations for sequential lobing type of thing, so they are, these is also almost constant and independent of the radar range. Now if we add all these noise, then so total error for monopulse will be like this. So at lower range, glint predominates, and higher range, receiver noise predominates. Now if you consider the conical scan, the nature of the curve is almost identical, but point is that the amount of error for conical scan is little bit larger compared to the monopulse counterpart because of the amplitude fluctuations present for this type of sequential lobing or conical scan. So these are the limitations of tracking accuracy and corresponding errors. So let us stop here right now. We will see you in the next class.